Feeling like taking a coffee break? So do I. What about we talk about pattern matching, one of the main features brought to you by the project Amber, and that is slowly, almost silently, changing the way you will be writing Java code. And if you think that pattern matching is about matching strings of characters, maybe you can watch the following. First of all, just a quick recap. The project Amber is developed at the OpenJDK and has already delivered several key elements of the Java language. Among them are text blocks, an overworld of switch statements, switch expressions, records, and seal types. Not bad. It has also delivered what is called pattern matching for Instanceof. And this pattern matching stuff is precisely what I would like to talk to you about in this JEP Café. What is this pattern matching for Instanceof about? Well, I guess you all wrote this piece of code once or twice in your applications, at least. You know you get this object, and you know that this object is in fact a string of character, and you want to use it as such. So, just to be sure, you first check for its exact type with an instance of, and when you're sure this is a string, then you can cast it. In fact, writing this code is pretty annoying, because you have the feeling that you need to tell the compiler twice that this O reference is actually a string. Well, first good news, which in fact is not completely new because it's part of the JDK 16, you can now write this code in that way. This is the JEP 394, link in the description down below. You have this nice little piece of syntax that allows you to check for the type of O and create the S variable of the right type, in that case string, at the same time in one go. It's a nice thing to have, it just makes your code easier to write, less technical and more readable. You may be thinking that this is just a syntactic sugar. That is nice to have, but not a revolution. In fact, it is a revolution. This piece of code is actually a pattern. And what you are really doing in this instance of is matching the O variable, the O reference, to this pattern string S. Before we deep dive into this, let me tell you something. Pattern matching is probably the third major revolution of the Java language. The first revolution was the introduction of parameters type in Java 5. That was in 2004. Java was almost 10 years old at that time, and the way Java implemented that is called generics. You all know generics. We use generics daily in our code without even thinking about it. The second revolution was the implementation of function types. That was in Java 8, back in 2014. Java was almost 20 years old. And of course, these are lambda expressions, you all know that. Maybe some of you remember the time before lambdas, or even before generics. Well, these two revolutions have one thing in common. They were big bangs in a JDK. In one go, all the collection framework was rewritten to support generics. And the same happened for lambdas. Suddenly, boom, lambdas were all over the place. New methods in collections. The stream API to process in-memory data was added to the JDK. These two features completely changed the way we now write programs in Java, and they were introduced in one go in a JDK. But now we know that there was really a time before and after generics, and the same for lambdas. For pattern matching, things are different. No big bang, no massive delivery of a huge pack of changes in a JDK. Pattern matching is coming one small bit at a time, step by step, slowly, almost silently. But my guess is that it's going to be the same as with generics and lambdas. The revolution will be huge. Probably in 10 years from now, someone will ask, do you remember the time before pattern matching? Parameter types, function types, pattern matching, maybe the three ideas ring a bell? Well, it all comes from functional programming back in the 70s. These ideas are nothing but new. What is new is that pattern matching is coming to the Java language. So, first of all, what is a pattern? What is it made of? In pattern matching, there are just two words, pattern and matching. When you write O instance of string S, what do you match? Simple, you match O. So O is called the target operand. This is what you match. You match O against string S. So string S is the pattern itself. This pattern has a type, because what you're really matching is the type of O against the type string. So we say that string is a type pattern. And this type is string. So string is the name of these patterns. Type patterns are not the only patterns, and you will see that in a minute. The last element of this pattern is the S variable. This variable is created only if O matches the pattern, that is, if O is of type string. This variable, in this context, is called the binding variable of the pattern. A type pattern has only one binding variable, but there are patterns that can have more than one binding variables. You will see that in a minute. The nice thing with pattern matching for Instanceof is that you can use this binding variable wherever it makes sense to use it. Of course, this if block is the most obvious place where you can use it, but you can also use it after a Boolean AND operator, for instance. This kind of code is indeed legal. And there is even a nice syntactic element that has been added to this pattern matching for Instanceof. Suppose you have a method that takes a plain object, and in fact you don't want to process elements that are not strings of characters. Then, instead of writing this kind of code, let me call it ugly code, you can now write this one. It may not be the nicest piece of code you've ever written, but I think it's still much cleaner than the previous one. If the code you write in the if block exits the method, it could be a return or the throwing of an exception, then you can use the S binding variable in the rest of the method. But if your code can traverse both the if block and the rest of the method, then no binding variable for you. Sorry, but the compiler will not let you use this S variable. Okay, so at this point, you have one kind of pattern, which is the type pattern, and one place to use this pattern, which is the instance of. The second place where you can use patterns is the switch statement and the switch expression. The fourth preview of this feature is described in the JEP 433, a candidate for the JDK 20, released in March 2023. You know that a switch statement or a switch expression allow for three kinds of case constants: integers, enumerated values, and strings of character. Well, the plan is to add patterns to the lot. So in the case of a switch expression, you could write this kind of code. Suppose that shape is an interface, for instance, with two implementations, circle and square. Then computing the surface of a shape could look like this code. See, you are switching on a shape object, and the switch will match this shape object to the different patterns you have as case labels. So, if it is a circle, you will execute this code with so-called as a binding variable. And if it is a square, you will execute this other code with square as a binding variable. And if it is neither circle nor square, then you will execute the default branch. Note that if shape is a sealed interface with only two permitted implementations, circle and square, then you do not need this default branch. The compiler can see that your switch covers all the possible cases. There are several refinements to this nice syntax. First, you can handle null values explicitly with a null case. No more null pointer exceptions in switch statements, which is nice. Second, you can add Boolean expressions to the pattern case with a when, just like this. In a preview version of this feature, pattern matching for switch, this was called the guarded pattern and the syntax was a little different. This when keyword was not there. So if you come across documentation on the web talking about guarded patterns, just so you know, it's not up to date anymore. Now, instead of guarded pattern, we have this when, which cleanly separates the pattern itself from the Boolean expression. It's easy to spot in your code and probably makes it more readable. Remember though that this is still a preview feature, so it may change again before becoming a final feature. The next type of pattern I would like to talk to you about that appeared as a preview feature in the JDK 19 and that should also be a preview feature of the JDK 20 is the record pattern. This is the JEP 432. Records are a new feature of the JDK 16. It's the JEP 395. In a nutshell, it's an aggregate of data that is non-modifiable and that you can declare in a very simple and convenient way with just a single line of code. By just declaring this record, the compiler creates a final class for you with final fields, with accessors, a constructor called the canonical constructor, and as a bonus, a toString equals and hashcode method. If you want to learn more about records, you can definitely read the JEP 395, of course, and you can also check the episode 8 of this JEP Café series. Links are in the description down below. One of the key points about record is that this declaration shows you all the state a record can carry. You cannot add any other state to this record. And this can be leveraged by pattern matching. Record pattern matching is about extracting this state with a simple declaration. Suppose you have this kind of code, classical pattern matching, for instance, of, with a type pattern. In fact, the compiler knows that the record point is built on two components, X and Y. The reason is that this is how the point record is declared. Record pattern matching is just this syntax, where you declare X and Y as binding variables following the declaration of your record. Super simple, super slick, super clean. I love it. And if you still need a reference to the point itself, you can also add it. Note that to initialize the X and Y binding variables, the compiler actually calls the accessors of the corresponding components. So if you have some kind of validation or defensive copy in these accessors, all this is properly called, is properly executed. This syntax is not some kind of backdoor that could break your code. So yes, that's another kind of pattern. Great. Can you use it in switches also? Absolutely. Do you remember our previous example to compute the surface of a square and a circle? Well, assuming that square and circle are records, you can now write it in that way. Cleaner code, easier to read, even better. The JDK 20 should bring the second preview of the record pattern matching feature, and with it, several things are being added. First, the possibility to nest record patterns. Suppose you have a square record built on two instances of another record named point. Well, you can create a record pattern by nesting records patterns in that way. It makes sense and makes your code more compact. Be careful though not to nest too many elements because it may make your code harder to read. As usual, this is a great feature, just be cautious not to overuse it. And by the way, you can also leverage type inference with the var keyword there. Another great addition of record pattern matching. Where can you use record patterns? Well, first, wherever you can use type patterns, because they are patterns. So that is instance of and switch label, whether it is in switch statements and switch expression. But that's not all. There is a little surprise for you there. You can also use them in our good old for statement. Suppose that point is a record and you have a list of points, and you need to iterate over the elements of that list. You are going to write this kind of code. Just take a closer look at it. This point declaration. Don't you think that it looks like some kind of pattern? A type pattern, to be more precise? Of course, when it was introduced in Java 5, pattern matching was not a thing in Java. But now, it is. So would it mean that this code could actually be a real type pattern? Would it mean that you could write it with a record pattern instead of this type pattern? Something like this? Well, actually, this syntax is also described in this JEP 432 and could be supported in the JDK 20, also as a preview feature, as part of this record pattern preview feature. And this is really awesome. There are several points where you need to be extra careful with this feature, especially if you have null elements in this list. Obviously, you cannot call the accessors of a record on a null element. So in that case, you will get an exception, namely a match exception, new type of exception, with the null pointer exception as the root cause of this match exception. Okay, let me wrap up all this. Currently, you have two kinds of patterns. Type patterns, available already as a final feature of the JDK, and record patterns, still a preview feature. More patterns are in the work. Array patterns to deconstruct arrays, and patterns based on arbitrary classes rather than only record classes, and some others. Second, where can you use pattern? Three places. The first one is the Instanceof operator. This is a final feature of the JDK. The second one are switch labels within switch statements and switch expressions. This is still a preview feature in the JDK 20. And the third one could be this enhanced for loop that could also be available as a preview feature in the JDK 20. There may be more in the future. Don't worry, we'll talk about it in this JEP Café when it's ready. So stay tuned for more. And with this, I'm out of coffee. So that's it for today. Talk to you soon.